excited to be here. We're going to have a great time tonight. Listen, I love these moments because it's like we just take a moment to strip everything back, hear some stories behind the songs. And I don't know, I just love these intimate moments where hopefully you get to know me a little bit better. But most of all, I just hope you get to know Jesus better tonight. And if you're anything like me in the craziness of life, we all just need a moment to exhale, right? And I pray that tonight is one of those moments where you can be reminded of who he is and who you are because of him. The presence of Jesus changes everything. And my prayer is that tonight you will experience his presence, all right? Lost are saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place at the sound of your great name. Of your great name. If you know it, sing it out. Jesus, worthy is the Lamb that was slain for us. Son of God and man, you are high and lifted up. And all the world will praise your great name. Yeah. Thank you. Y'all, you sound amazing. Thank you so much for singing along. And just, y'all look great for a Saturday night, especially you beautiful girls right down here. You're making me miss my own daughters. I've got three ones. And twin daughters, Gracie and Bella, that are 10, and another little one, Sadie, that's 6. And we just had spring break, but my husband, God bless him, flew them home all by himself today on an airplane, all three girls. And I might have been texting him. I'm so thankful for Wi-Fi in the air now. I'm like, how are they doing now? He's like, would you stop texting me? They're fine. Everybody's still alive. So they made it home in one piece. Way to go, Dad. Way to go. Well, hey, listen, we're so excited just to be able to play some of these songs for you. This song, which is the title cut off of my last project, it was important to me because I feel like just we're living in a time where we need to do less arguing and less talking about all the things we think this means and all the stuff this needs to be, and we just need to live it. The world is desperate for the hope and the love of Jesus, and I think the best way for them to experience that is through his followers. So I was praying that this would be really a motivation and an inspiration, not just for people who heard this song, but a reminder to myself, not because I can stand up here and sing behind a shiny microphone and quote some Bible verses that hopefully will minister to people. But what do I live when I'm off the stage and out from underneath the spotlight? How am I loving my kids? How am I serving my husband and my community and my neighborhood? What is my life telling the world that I believe? And I wrote this song to be a reminder for you, but hopefully for me, that it's up to you and me to be one.
Steady, question what we really have to give. Stay where it's safer, claim faith but waver. Is this how we're really meant to live? We pray but never move, we say but never do.
You know what? I just love the power of a song. I was explaining this even to my little girls were asking the other day why at church they always, like, when the preachers get into the end of the sermon, the keyboard player comes out, right? And they always start to, like, play that kind of moody music underneath. My daughter goes, why do they always do that? And I said, because music has such a way of preparing the heart, right? It has a way of, like, opening our heart up to hear maybe what we wouldn't hear just with words alone. And it has a way to make us feel like we can celebrate. It has a way to make us feel like we can dance. Music has a way to make us feel like we can cry. Music has a way of going straight to the heart, I think, in a way that words alone just can't do. And I'm so grateful for the power of music. And that's why I'm so grateful for Christian radio, because, you know, I say this all the time. They are the greatest missionaries in our communities, right? Because there's a lot of people who will never walk through the back door of a church, but everybody gets just a little bit tired of the song that's playing on their radio, and they switch through, and they have an opportunity to come in contact with the message of Jesus Christ in a way that just is incredible to me. The opportunity and the missionaries. So for you that are here that actually work for K-Love, all of you are a part of that mission. And we thank you so, so much for what you're doing to take that message into places that I may never get. The message gets to that place because of you. So thank you. And I think that this song is a great example of that for me. I remember when I wrote it, it was brought to me by a husband and wife named Sam and Becca Mizell, and they actually had written the chorus. And the first time I just heard the very first line, I went, that is absolutely like a page out of my journal. I am a type A control freak. I don't know if anybody else will admit that, but I like to have all of my things planned. I'm like, I have notes and plans and everything written out, and then I just hope that God will come along and make it all just turn out the way that I know I've planned it, because I know how I plan it is the right way. Thank goodness that he is God and I am not, but I need that constant reminder when things don't turn out the way that I've planned. And so when I first wrote this song, and I wrote the verses and I wrote the bridge to kind of go along with the very first time I heard that chorus, I had no idea that it would become like an anchor for so many other people, because really, I wrote it as a reminder for myself. I struggle with fear greatly. I struggle so often with doubts, but I'm so grateful that who he is not dependent on how I feel. He is who he is in spite of my ever-changing emotions and feelings. Aren't you grateful for that? That who he is not dependent on our human emotion. And it just so happens that I feel like maybe this song came along at a time that people needed a reminder that he's in control, that he's on the throne. And whether it's in your own family tonight, some of you who are sitting here like, I'm just going to sit here and have a good time, but you're going to leave here and go back into situations that I couldn't begin to understand. Some of you are struggling in your marriage, struggling with your kids. Or maybe for some of you, it's just taking a look at the world at large and going, oh, things seem hopeless. Things seem dark. And I feel like sometimes the media almost wants to sensationalize that and make us feel like this is the darkest time ever in the history of the world. But last time I checked, hope still lives. Hope is alive in the person of Jesus Christ. That hope is alive and well. That's a hope that never dies. So maybe you need to be reminded tonight that he's still on the throne. He's still in control. That his ways are good, his plans are perfect, he is faithful, and he is the King of the world. I try to fit you in the walls inside my mind. Try to keep you safely in between the lines. I try to put you in the box that I've designed. I try to pull you down so we are eye to eye. When did I forget that you've always been
the king of the world. I try to take life back right out of the hands of the king of the world. How could I make you so small when you're the one who holds it all? When did I forget that you've always been the king of the world? Just a whisper of your voice can tame the seas. So who am I to try to take the lead? Oh. Still I run ahead and I think that I'm strong enough. Eh? When you're the one who made me from the dust, when did I try to take life back right out of the hands of the king of the world? How could I make you so small when you're the one who holds it all? When did I forget that you've always been the king of the world? Ooh, you've set it all in motion.
Trust you. We need to trust.
trust you.
Southern accent. It's totally made up. I live in Nashville, Tennessee, and I've lived there. It's hard for me to believe I've lived there for 20 years. What in the world? But I'm a Seattle girl at heart. I was born and raised in Seattle, Washington. And when I was growing up in Seattle, it's funny because it's not really the hotbed of Christian anything. They say it's the least church city in the nation. Less than 1% of the population claims to go to church of any kind. So the fact that I was born into a Christian family, thank you, Jesus, and raised in an amazing church, I'm forever grateful for. And I'm really so unbelievably extra excited that Caleb decided to show up in Seattle as well. So, woo! Hallelujah! But you know what? Growing up, it's just not exactly like, is it not Christian-y? It's not real soulful and gospel either, but yet there's just something about soulful music that I have loved my entire life. And I think it might have something to do with the fact that my dad used to play a singer on vinyl for me when I was a little girl almost every day, and her name was Mahalia Jackson. Now, I loved Mahalia Jackson, and if you've never heard of her, shame on you, go home and YouTube, because it is fantastic. And it was the first time, as just a little tiny girl, I was like, I had no idea that you could throw your whole self into singing, from the top of your head to the bottom of your feet and everywhere in between. And that's how Mahalia did it. And so I know that I do not look like Mahalia Jackson, but when I was singing into my hairbrush, I was Mahalia Jackson, all right? All my little friends were listening to their Nirvana and all their, you know, grunge music and not shaving their armpits and hugging the trees and whatever those people in Seattle do. But I was listening to Mahalia and Aretha and Stevie. That's just the music I loved growing up. And so I wrote this song, man, it's probably been about a decade ago, but I wrote it with just kind of that Mahalia spirit in mind. And so I'm going to take you to church just a little bit, if that's all right here tonight. All right? All right. All right. I remember Mama praying, saying to me, girl, child, you better know before you walk out in the world. The times, they're getting darker, they're getting harder every day. And when they do, I hear my mama say, as you get older, towards the sun. If you feel scared and so alone, you're not the only one. Don't be afraid when the world, it comes undone. 'Cause don't you know that someday the king will come. As I keep growing, he keeps showing me strength. Oh, even when the world is changing, he remains the same, yes he does. He loves me like a father, his hands will provide. He takes away every fear inside. As we get older, when it's cold, or run towards the sun. If you feel scared and so alone, you're not the only one. Don't be afraid when the world, time has breath after that. Oh, that was fun. Thank you so much. And well done. Give it up for these guys behind me because they are doing an amazing job. You know, it's one thing to like write an acoustic song. It's another thing to take a song that has all of this instrumentation and then be able to strip everything away and still be able to pull it off. And these guys are complete pros behind me. So thank you so, so much. Oh, you know, I've been writing songs for a long time, and it's funny because actually when I first started, I was not a songwriter. I recorded a lot of other people's songs, and though I still don't write every song, your great name, I did not write that song, but I was grateful to be the first one to record it, and I think now, if I'm going to record a song that somebody else wrote, it's because it has to strike a chord with my own story. And I began to learn that singing somebody else's spiritual experience all the time, while it may be an incredible song, it just was harder to be authentic and true to my own story. And there's really nothing better than just your own story. And yet it's so funny that so often we want a different story, right? We don't want people to see our true story because we're longing for somebody else's story that we think is better. And especially if we spend our time on social media, everybody makes their story look amazing on Instagram. And then we're looking at their story going, I want that story. But you know what? When we can understand that we're not really the author of our story anyway, that he's the one that's holding the pen, and he's the one who has the final say over our lives when we give him the control to write it, he writes it in his own time and in the most perfect way. And as I began to write songs, even though I still don't consider myself to be this like professional songwriter, my husband, who is an amazing songwriter, he can wake up every day and say, well, today I'm gonna write 2 songs. And then he goes on and writes 3. And I'm thinking, I don't know how you do that. I have to be in the moment and feel inspired. And that's usually the way that my process has always gone, and none more true than this next song. And I've never heard God speak audibly, and I've been listening for a whole lot of years, so if you've heard the big voice in the sky, well, good for you. But I have so never heard it for myself. But the longer that I've been walking with him, the more I can recognize that still, small voice in my spirit. And when I say that I feel like he was holding the pen when I wrote this song, I don't say that lightly. I really do. And I've never had an experience like it. I wrote it in about 20 minutes, and it was after a really difficult meeting with a dear friend who was coming to terms with just some horrific things that had happened to her in her childhood. And I just remember as she was sitting with me, she just kept saying, oh, it's too dirty, it's too dirty. And she left my house that day, and I just walked up and down the hallway going, but there's nothing too dirty. That's the thing, there's nothing too dirty. Religion tries to tell us that there's these kind of rules and that God is standing with his clipboard and checking us off every time we make a mistake. Oh, but then Jesus enters the story and the clipboard is thrown away, y'all. Grace does not have an expiration date. I hope that we all can remember that his grace does not have an expiration date. It has nothing to do with religion. We're choking on religion in this country. We don't need any more religion, but a relationship with Jesus Christ changes everything. It changes everything. And as I wrote this song that day, I just had such a sense that this was a message he wanted sung over his children. Not just the world, but his children who have forgotten what it means to be a child of God. That he takes the old and he makes it brand new. And sometimes I think we put on our happy faces and our Christian smiles and we feel like we have to have the nice, perfect little Christian answer for everything when we're actually shriveling up on the inside. But Jesus came so that we could be free and have an abundant life. And he says that he takes all the old junk and he makes it new. And that scripture in the Bible, which is one of my favorites, it's not just a one-time thing. I looked it up, and in the original, it's talking about a water wheel that goes around dirty and comes up clean, goes around dirty and comes up clean, and it's a continual, never-ending process. That's what his grace is. That's what it does. I wrote this song, That Day Is a Gift, and I pray that for some of you who are hearing it, maybe you will be reminded exactly what it is that Jesus does for every single one of us. I see shattered, you see whole. I see broken, but you see beautiful. And you're helping me to believe. You're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. I am clean. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. Dead now lives again. My heart's beating, it's beating inside my chest. 'Cause I'm coming alive with joy and destiny. Washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood flowed red, it made me white. My dirty rags are purified, I am clean, oh yes. Washed in the blood of your sacrifice, your blood flowed red, it made me white. Purified.
trail of galaxies and dream of me. What kind of love is writing my story till the end with mercy's pen? Only you. What kind of king would choose to wear a crown that bleeds and scars to win my heart? What kind of love tells me I'm the reason he can't stay inside the grave?
Alive.
hands have made. I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my song. But then I